This Blender tutorial is covering a cool tip to take a basic PBR material and then add dirt and grunge over it to break up the repeating pattern, adding realism and making it more interesting. And this is all without any add-ons. There are a few steps to this, but the beauty is that even the first step might be enough to accomplish what you need. But stay with me, because each step we take, the material looks better and better, and we get more and more control over how it looks. I'll explain everything I can along the way. Let's go. So here we have a free PBR texture from Ambient CG. Right out of the box, it's a decent texture, using just four image maps: a color image, a roughness map, normal map, and displacement map. It's a good material, but if we had this all over a big scene, we'd start to notice a repeating pattern. It will look very monotonous, not very interesting, and pretty unrealistic. But we can overlay a single image texture, such as this free one from Unsplash, or these from textures.com, to give it some real character. I'll assume you know how to set up a basic PBR material. If not, I have a full and free two-part tutorial on how to set up materials you should watch first. You may notice the layout of my workspace is probably different than yours. I have a 3D viewport here, a shader editor below, UV editor in the top left, and on the right I have both the properties panel and outliner side by side. The default workspace looks more like this, but it'll require clicking back and forth or changing screens a lot for what we are trying to accomplish. I like textures.com for images like this, but I'm using this one from Unsplash because I can include it in the project file without violating any rules. It's a simple image of a grungy surface. It doesn't need to be crazy high resolution, and it doesn't need to be alpha masked. This image will work perfectly, but if you're doing a big scene, you may want to grab a few different ones to mix it up on different objects. The plane on the left has just the basic PBR material, and we will add this effect to the plane on the right. With our basic PBR setup, just drag and drop this image into the shader editor. It automatically creates an image texture node and loads the image into it. We will mix this image with the image that's supplying the color data for the material. This is done with a mix node. And here's a little side note about the mix node. In previous versions of Blender, we had something called a mix RGB node, which mixed colors together. And we had a separate mix node, which mixed other values. They've since combined these into just a single mix node. And when we add a mix node, we then choose the type of values we are going to mix. The options are float, value, and color. Choosing color essentially turns this into what the mix RGB node used to be. Also, when you search for mix in the nodes, you may see a mix color node. This is actually the exact same node as the mix node, only it is added with color already selected by default. I just wanted to clear things up in case anyone ever watches an older tutorial where they refer to the mix RGB node. Okay, back to what we were doing. The mix node set to color will mix two colors together. The color that's placed into the top yellow socket will be placed on the object first. Then the material on the bottom will be placed on top of that material. This is somewhat opposite of most other graphics programs, where usually the bottom layer is on, well, the bottom. The selector that defaults to mix lets us use different methods to mix these two colors together. Each option combines the two colors in a different way. The factor determines how much and where the mixing occurs. Both of these will be really important for what we're trying to do. So let's connect our original material's image, that's the image of the bricks, to the top socket because it will be the base color. Then let's drag the new image into the bottom socket. Connect this mix node into the color input of the principled shader, where the first color image was previously connected. Right now, we may notice some very subtle changes to the material, but not much. That's partially because of the method being used to mix these two. It's using the default mix method, and the factor is only set to 50%. If we change the mix method to multiply, the new material will become a little darker. You can play around with other mixing methods and see what they do. But in almost every case for me, multiply seems to work the best. Then we can crank up the factor setting, and more of the second image is multiplied into the base image. That's something, but we can do a lot better than this with the next step. If you're still watching, hitting that like button helps me more than you know. And if you haven't already, I would love to have you as a subscriber. Thank you so much, and let's continue. Let's mix up how much and where this texture is mixed into the underlying image. This may be a little unorthodox, but we are going to also connect the color output of this overlaid texture into the factor of the mix node. And when we do this, the material kind of goes back to normal. But then let's add a color ramp node between these two. Slide the colors of the color ramp closer together, and for you, you'll just have to play around with this until you get something you like. There's no absolute setting that's going to work for everything. But you see that now the new material is showing up in certain places more than others. This may seem subtle, but it's breaking up the monotony of the texture. The next step might not be necessary for what you're trying to do, but on some scenes, it's going to be the most important step of all, and that's to give this overlaid texture its own UV map, so it can be moved around on the object independently of the underlying texture. This is very powerful and not incredibly difficult. But right now, if we go into the UV editor for this object, we have one UV, and adjusting the UV map adjusts both the base material and the grungy stuff we put on top of it. They move together, at least for right now. With this object selected, go to the Properties panel, and in the Object Data Properties, that's the triangle-looking tab, there's a section for UV maps. Expanding that, we see we have one UV map on this object. Press the plus icon, and it adds a second UV map to the object. We could eventually add more and more if we wanted to stack more and more layers on top of each other, but we are keeping this one simple. And for most things you're going to try to do, just two UVs will be plenty. Now this part is important and a little confusing. For demonstration, I'll select the new UV map and unwrap the object again. It only unwraps the second UV map, but it leaves the first the way we had it before. The camera icon over here, I believe, indicates which UV map is being used as the default, but which UV map is highlighted, regardless of which has the camera icon, is the one that will be editable in the UV editor. We change which one's being used by default by clicking the camera icon, and we change which one we want to work on simply by highlighting it. Be very careful from this point on that if you're making changes to a UV map, you have the proper one selected. It's very easy to accidentally make changes to the wrong one. In the shader editor, the base PBR material is mapped to the default UV map, and that's fine. But let's go up to the new image node, which contains the overlaid grunge texture. Shift A to add a new node and search for a UV map node. This node lets us select a specific UV map and use it to map whatever it plugs into. Plug the purple output of the UV map node into the purple vector input of this image texture. Then in this box, choose the second UV map that we just created. Now, all of this stuff down here, the stuff that makes the bricks, is all controlled by the first default UV map. But this image is controlled by the second UV map. With the second UV map highlighted in the data properties, go to the UV editor and make adjustments. See what's happening? The grunge overlay is being adjusted, but not the bricks beneath it. Move, rotate, and scale to make the effect look just how you want it. If we wanted to move the bricks around, we would have to go back to the default UV map and select that one. Then we could change those. So again, make sure you have the right one selected. We could unwrap different parts of an object on this second UV map, and with just one texture, get infinite variations of grunge just by moving and resizing it for each component. An important note here is that any object we apply this material to will need that second UV map. So we have to add a second UV map to every object we place this material on. I recommend not changing the default name of the added UV maps, because you'll have to have the names be the same on all objects this is applied to. And renaming it is just an extra step that you may have to take many times. This next step I wasn't going to initially include, because for what I use this for, it usually doesn't matter that much. But I realize it is useful, and inevitably someone will call me out for not covering it. And that's having this image also affect the roughness of the underlying brick material. If we get up close and at an angle, we see the overlaying image is not affecting the roughness or reflectiveness of this wall at all. We probably want it to, and it's pretty easy to do. Where the roughness connects to the principled shader, add another mix node, or mix color node, same thing as we discussed earlier. I'll just copy this one here and drag it down here. Now, this color ramp, which makes the decision of where the color is mixed together, we are going to have it also control where the change in roughness occurs. We will want to use a different mix method for this. You can experiment to see why, but to cut to the chase, add seems to work the best. So change this to add, and the overlaid material's value will be added on top of the base roughness. From here, there are at least two ways we could do this. The first is super easy, and it's just to have the color ramp's output feed into the second input of the mix node. Right away, when I toggle this mix node on and off, we see that it's causing a significant difference in the roughness. The dark materials are way less shiny with it added. If we wanted it to be more shiny on the dark parts, as if they were wet, we could change from add to subtract. With this method, the factor will control how strong the effect is. The second method of doing this would be, instead of plugging the color ramp into the second color input, plug it into the factor. Then adjust the strength by making the second color lighter or darker. There are scenarios where this works better, but in this case, both seem to achieve the desired effect. Here's another version of this following the exact same steps, but with a different image to give the effect of leaks running down the wall. I just had to move the UV map around to line it up the way I wanted. And here's another version with a grungy buildup at the bottom. I think this is a really cool effect in Blender. And once you do it a couple times, the steps are pretty simple. More simple than they may seem right now. For just a few dollars of support on Patreon, you get this project file, and I'm including a cheat sheet with each step of this process laid out for future reference. Your continued support on my journey to 100K YouTube subscribers means the world to me. Hit that like button. Thank you so much, and stay creative.